got the amphibian, a monster from inner space. What you see here took more than 6 months to create. It's made of such materials as plastic, foam rubber, and polyethylene, and weighs more than 100 pounds. The designer of this beautiful creature is one of these three men. Let's meet him now. What is your name, please?
My name is Richard Casarino.
My name is Richard Casarino.
My name is Richard Casarino.
Only one of these men is the real Richard Casarino. The other two are imposters and will try to fool this panel. Tom Poston, Peggy Cass, Orson Bean, and Kitty Carlisle on To Tell the Truth. This portion of To Tell the Truth is brought to you by New Dawn Hair Color. And now, here's our host on To Tell the Truth, Bob Collier.
Thank you. Welcome once again to Tell the Truth. Good afternoon, panel.
Good afternoon,
how do you like that amphibious monster, huh?
It's very scary.
There he is again.
About that. In front of you are today's envelopes, the contents of which you've never seen. Open up envelope number one, if you will, then you can follow along with me. I, Richard Casarino, make movie monsters. Horrifying, terrifying, live-action monsters to scare the wits out of moviegoers. My newest monster is in Destination Inner Space, and it's the first monster ever to work underwater without external diving gear attached. I built scuba gear into it, climbed in myself, and dived down. I have designed 7 monsters in all. 5 of them use human actors inside the costumes, and 2 operate mechanically. They were creatures like a space monster, a giant octopus, and the sun demon. They're all fake, but the howls of fear in movie theaters are very real. Signed, Richard Casarino.
He doesn't understand English, don't you realize
that? Sir, speak to him in his native tongue.
No, just go like this. You see, he follows your hand and he'll turn around. Now, you watch. See there?
Beautiful.
See there?
Yeah, let's see the other side.
You find out for yourself. All right. We'll start the questioning with Peggy Cass. Peggy? Yeah.
Peggy Casarino. Number 3, who's Tony Sarg?
I don't know.
Now, number 1, how much did it cost to make that?
Well, this particular one cost about $28,000.
$28,000? Well, what does it do outside of being ugly?
Well, this is one of our newest.
Oh, I'm sorry. I beg your pardon.
Darn cute for a monster.
Well, this one, actually, we can submerge in water as we...
You mean the guy has a face...
An aqualung, yes.
I see. Gee, it doesn't look as though he's got an aqualung, because where would he carry it? Number 2, why is his stomach different than the rest of him?
His stomach?
Well, isn't that a stomach there?
Well, that's just a design put in.
Oh,
there.
I thought maybe that was where you could kill him, his soft underbelly.
Well, you can. He's been...
Orson Bean.
Thank you. Number 3, who was... Mercy, he has a temper, doesn't he?
He's just covered his underbelly, that's all. Right.
Who was... Number 3, who do you happen to know who was responsible for the creature from the Black Lagoon?
Bud Westmore.
It was a Bud Westmore monster,
well.
Eh? Yeah. Number 1, how about the attack of the crab monsters? One of the lesser efforts. You know who made them crabs?
Who made the crabs?
Yeah. Special effect fella.
Yes, it might have been Westmore or Shields. I'm not sure of that.
Number 2, how about, do you have anything to do with the monsters, like for Frankenstein monster faces and things like
Frank
that?
Frank Shields did that for Universal.
Did he? Yeah, those were all for Universal.
Which one?
Kitty Carlisle.
Number 1, is the aqualung in the back fin of the monster?
No, it's actually, well, it's between the fin and the man's body strapped on his back.
Number 2, how does he, is it, the reason I asked him to turn around is, how does he get in and out of it? Is it zipped up the back?
It's zipped up the back and along the legs. Those feet, his fins, are specially put on after he has the suit on. The hat, the head comes different, separately.
Number 3, well then how is it possible for him to be submerged? Is it watertight?
No, it is not.
It is not? Uh-huh. Number one, where does Westmore, what studio does Westmore work out of?
Well, he does work for various studios in Hollywood now, and...
Mostly where?
Tom Poston.
Well, I'd like to ask number two, how come number three didn't know Tony Sorg? Do you know him, number
yes,
two?
Yes, puppeteer in the early 30s.
Thank you. That, where did you get the idea for him, number one? He looks something like a cornerback who has just seen a man catch a pass right in front of him. Where did you get the idea for this monster, number one?
Well, the design was by my associate, and...
Pardon me?
I say the design was by an associate of mine, and we did the actual mechanical work on the...
Thank you. Number three, do you know William Castle?
I believe he's a director or a producer.
Thank you. How come you didn't know Tony Sorg?
He's too young.
I don't know him either.
That's it. Time for you to mark your ballot. So please mark them at once, if you will, please. Without change, without any consultation. Just vote. Vote for number one.
How long can he live out of water, bud?
Number two, we'll find out. Or number three.
All very good.
Okay. The team of challengers will, of course, receive $100 for each incorrect vote. Are your ballots all marked? All right, Tom, for whom did you vote?
I voted for number three because he was undecided about whether Bill Castle was a director or producer. And I worked for Bill on several occasions, and there were many times when I asked myself exactly the same question. I'm just kidding.
Peggy Cass.
Great director.
Well, you know, now that I voted for him, I don't think it is him. I voted for three. We won't win in grammar lessons.
Orson.
Just so hard. I like the way number two said Frank Shields or somebody did it for Universal. That sounds like parlance of the trade. And I almost voted for him, and then I got touted onto one. But at the last minute, I switched to three because of the Bill Castle thing that he knew. But he could be a liar.
Kitty Carlisle.
I voted for number three because of the way the monster put his hand on his shoulder up there. I felt they had an affinity for each other.
Affinity. What a play on what? I don't know. Affinity. Wow. All right, the votes are all in. So let's find out the truth, shall we? Will the real Richard Casarino please stand up? Teddy, you got the brights today, haven't you, huh? Really got the brights.
That's just a fluke, though.
Yeah.
Number one, what is your real name and what do you really do?
My name is Alan Nastassi, and I'm an attorney in New York City.
And number two, what is your real name and what do you do, sir?
My name is John Pierotti, and I'm the sports cartoonist for the New York Post. Oh,
thank you. And checking the votes, we find there were no incorrect votes. So, gentlemen, there's still a $75 coming your way. Who was the monster?
Who was the monster?
Well, he's one of our young, fine actors who sits in for you when we're rehearsing the show. And we are very happy to have had you here today. And there's still, as I said, is $75 coming your way. And I hope you had a good time, too. Glad you weren't inside the costume. You were more comfortable this way. Goodbye, and God bless you. Now, before we meet our next team of challengers, we'd like to tell you about a very lucky purchase.
Our next guest, on To Tell the Truth, bought this old typewriter for only $9. It started him on a brand new career, which has already earned him $10,000. Let's meet him now. What is your name, please?
My name is Richard B. Coyner.
My name is Richard B. Coyner.
My name is Richard B. Coyner.
We'll learn more about Richard B. Coyner in a minute. Panel, open up your second envelope, if you will, and follow along. I, Richard B. Coyner, am an award-winning novelist. Before I started to write, I was a public relations man, a door-to-door salesman, a cartoonist, a banker, and a clerk. Not too long ago, I took a chance at an auction, and I bought a sealed box. When I opened it, I found an old typewriter. I had never typed and had never written anything before, but I decided to use the typewriter to write my first novel. It was published last week and is called Jack Be Quick. My publisher liked it so well that he gave me a $10,000 advance on my next novel.
Now I'm at work on a new story, but this time I was able to afford a new typewriter. Signed, Richard B. Coyner. We'll continue this game with Richard B. Coyner in half a minute after this message.
This portion of To Tell the Truth was brought to you by Rinse-Away. The next portion of To Tell the Truth is brought to you by Pepsodent, the toothpaste that cleans your teeth their whitest. And here once again is your host, Bud Collier.
Thank you, Johnny. Finally, these three men all claim to be Richard B. Coyner, award-winning novelist. We'll start the questioning, if we may, with Kitty Carlisle.
Thank you, Bud. I'm crazy about auctions. Number three, did you buy anything else at this auction besides the sealed box?
No, I bought the sealed box.
Where was the auction?
In a pawn shop.
Oh, what fun. Number two, what kind of an award did you get for your novel?
I won the Breadloaf Award.
Where's that given?
That's given here. It represents a conference in Middlebury College in Vermont.
Oh, number one, who is your publisher?
Lyle Stewart.
Number two, is that the only novel you've written, the one that won the award?
Yes, it is.
And now you're going to work on another one?
Yes.
What kind of a typewriter is that, number three?
It was a Royal.
It was a Royal.
It is a Royal. It is.
Number two, what are you going to buy now?
I expect to do a little writing first, then I'll buy later.
Do you write in longhand?
I write with a typewriter.
Oh, you do? Thank you.
Tom Poston.
I'd like to know what Jack B. Quick is about. Can you tell us, number one, please?
It's about many things. It's part of me, it's part of people I've met, and it's part of my life.
Thank you. I'm fascinated about the jobs you have held, whoever you are. Number three, what is a speedball to a cartoonist?
It's a lettering pen.
Thank you. Number three, where did you bank when you were a banker?
I banked at the Irving Trust Company in New York.
Okay, thank you, number two. Now, number three, will you tell me?
At Bowery Savings Bank in New York.
Oh, you were here in New York. Well, number one, where did your title come? Where did your prize award come from? Number two said Vermont or someplace. Where's yours?
It's the Breadloaf Award.
Which is?
It's from Middlebury College in Vermont.
Well, number one, how did you, what are you a New Yorker?
Yes, I am.
How did you apply for this award?
One does not apply for it. It is given.
Never gave it to me.
Never wrote a first novel.
Well, I read one.
Peggy Cash.
Number two, where is the McDowell Colony?
I don't know.
Thank you. Number three, how much did you pay for that typewriter in the sealed box?
$9.
Gee, number one, did you have a hunch it was a typewriter, or it could have been a bunch of garbage or something? I mean, sealed box and all. Did you have a feeling it was a typewriter?
I hadn't the vaguest idea what it was.
You're a real sport. Number two, did you always want to be a novelist?
No, I did not.
Well, I just can't get over that you get a typewriter and write a whole book just like that. Probably wasn't. Listen, number three, did the Breadloaf Award give you any money? Or just a little loaf of bread? I mean, is there bread connected with the Breadloaf Award?
No, there isn't.
Just the honor.
Just the honor.
It's the kind of things I always get.
Orson Bean.
Number one, what a strange way to have your whole life go. If there'd been a stuffed moose head in there, would you have gone into taxidermy or...
I don't know. I guess that it was always in the back of my mind to write a book one day.
That's a sensational thing. Number three, what's a hyphen? If you're a writer, you ought to know that.
It's an elongated dash.
Is it?
Yeah.
I thought it was just two little dots over each other. What are those?
No, that's an umlaut.
It's a colon.
It's an umlaut.
An umlaut is these two dots. That's talking about these two dots.
Oh, that's a colon.
That's a colon. All right.
Onto
number three, about your colon. Did you make up this name, Jack B. Quick, from the nursery rhyme? Like Jack B. Nimble?
Yes.
What does it have to do with your story?
The protagonist is named Jack.
Yeah?
And he's trying to get through life as quickly and as smoothly as possible.
I see. Number two, how about the income tax thing for writers? Has that been fixed around to where, like, you can spend 4 years writing a book and then it gets published and you make all the money in 1 year and it's not fair? Has that been changed?
I haven't enjoyed enough income as a writer to answer that.
Oh, I see.
That's all the time we have. It's time for you now to mark your ballot. So please mark them at once, without change, without any consultation, as before. Select, if you will, number one, number two, or number three. Ballots all marked?
Not Old Slowpoke.
Tom.
I marked.
For whom did you vote,
Old
Tom?
Slowpoke was marked. I voted for number three, and I'm glad to see that a lot of the members of the audience agreed with me. Or I
Peggy.
Agreed with Emerson.
You know, I was going to vote for one because he looks so much like Alan Hewitt, but I didn't. I voted for number three because of that speedball pin stuff. I don't know if it's true or not, but it sounded very professional.
Arthur.
Well, they're all very good. I voted for number three because of the speedball pen and because he looks like a writer to me. As the eyes, the haunted eyes of a man who has known hunger.
What makes with the umlaut?
That's an umlaut. I just threw it in to make it pretty.
Kitty.
Well, my husband wrote a play once about a typewriter that was delivered to a family and you can't take it with you.
Yes.
And I have a feeling that number one, who said his first novel was about himself, and I think most first novels are autobiographical, and so I voted for number one.
Hey, well, that broke the unanimity of it all so far, but we'll find out which one in truth is Richard B. Coyner in a minute. So, panel, the votes are all in, and to remind everybody, Kitty voted for number one, the rest of you all voted for number three. So, let's see now which one of these gentlemen in truth is the award-winning novelist. Will the real Richard B. Coyner, please. Stand up.
It's number two.
It's three.
Thank you, sir.
Is your novel already published, or when is it due to come out?
Well, it has been published as of November 8th.
Uh-huh. Well, much success to you. Hope it's a bestseller on every list in the land.
Thanks a lot.
And the next one, too.
Thanks.
Number one, what is your real name and what do you really do?
My name is Morton Sunshine, and I'm the general manager of the Grossinger Hotel and Country Club in Grossinger, New York.
Number two, what is your real name and what do you do, sir?
My name is David Hanna. I'm an account executive with the American Research Bureau, and we rate television programs.
Fine, there was one incorrect vote this time. You got him off the unanimous correct kick anyway, and that's worth $100 to you. And we thank you very much for visiting our show. Hope you look back on it as a happy experience. Goodbye, and God bless you. We'll be right back. Be sure to be with us tomorrow when once again we'll play our celebrity version of To Tell the Truth with another famous guest star. Goodbye, panel. See you tomorrow.
Oh,
see you tomorrow, too. In the meantime, don't you forget to tell the truth.
This portion of To Tell the Truth was brought to you by new Lux Liquid with Dermasil to make your hands prettier while you do dishes. To Tell the Truth is a Mark Woodson, Bill Todman production. Johnny Olson speaking, the program pre-recorded.